Good morning. We continue in our new study. Still a new year. Had a couple people already mentioned this morning they wish they could restart a couple weeks. And that's okay. There's still time for a new start. We're going to look at this morning a new message. If you see your bulletin, on the back of your bulletin will be the outline to follow along with this morning, some blanks that you can fill in with as we go through. One quick commercial announcement. At the end of service, if you didn't get your tithe record from last year, those will also be in the back and you can grab those. We're back to our regularly scheduled programming. All right, a new message. Have you ever sent a message that you wish you didn't send? And you hit the button and you were like, that was a mistake. Or you sent a message to the wrong person and you're just typing too fast and send it and we're like, oops, sorry. The messages that we send out are important. And once you send out a wrong message, it's already done, right? It's hard to backtrack and make a correction. Well, if you remember about 5 years ago, January 13th of 2018, a message was sent out to the island of Hawaii. Does anybody remember that? Let's put that message up there. Have you ever received alerts on your phone before? Gotten a message about an Amber Alert or a weather alert? Well, imagine you received this on your phone. You know how that sound goes off that and everybody's phone is blasting at one time? A message was sent out that said, a ballistic missile threat inbound to Hawaii. Seek immediate shelter. This is not a drill. That's pretty serious, right? You get this on your phone, what are you doing? You're running. You're calling your loved ones. Where are you at? What are you doing? Let's find shelter. This was sent out by mistake. But the panic was already done. The incorrect message sent out had consequences. As we are starting this new year, we must be careful about the message we send through our words and through our actions. Because if we have the wrong message, it has dire consequences. And of all the messages in the world, our message is the one that cannot be wrong. We cannot display the actions incorrectly. We cannot get the words wrong because our message has eternal consequences. We've been looking in Acts 9, the conversion of Saul. We saw last week his new start. He acknowledged who Jesus was, that Jesus is the Son of God, that he is Lord. He sought God's plan for his life. He followed it and he trusted that God would provide what he needed. Today, we're going to look at the new message that Paul had. His old message was a message that drove people away from Jesus Christ. And his new message drove people to Christ. So how can we make sure that we have the right message for this new year? The first thing that we're going to look at this morning, number one in your outline, the subject of our message. The subject of our message. We cannot get it wrong. Look. Well, it's up there. Who is it? Jesus. The subject of our message is Jesus. Acts chapter 9, verse 20. What did Saul do? It says, and straightway he preached who? Christ. Jesus Christ. He preached Christ in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. Who did he preach? He preached Jesus. Who else did he preach? No one. He preached Jesus. Why? Why is it only Jesus? Because he's the only way. He's the Savior. There is no hope in any other name. I know there's more of you that can give a heartier amen than that one. Do you believe it this morning? There is no other name than the name of Jesus. Amen. Only in Jesus is there salvation and hope. And if you don't believe me, turn to John 14:6. John 14:6, Jesus said this about himself. He said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Nobody is reconciled to God but through Jesus Christ. All men are born into sin. All men are sinners. Because of Adam and his sin, it has passed to all men. And the Bible says the wages of sin, the cost that I have to pay because I am a sinner, is death. But God sent his Son to die on the cross, to shed his blood, to be crucified, to take my punishment, my wage that I've earned upon himself. And he died and he was buried, and 3 days later he rose again, having victory over death. And by myself placing my faith in Jesus Christ, believing on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, turning from my sin and turning to God, I will be saved. It's only because of Jesus and his actions. There's no other name. The name of Jonathan Liggett gives you no hope. I'm sorry. The name of Jesus gives you hope. He is the subject. He is the name we proclaim. And Paul knew this. He went. He had met Jesus. He knew who Jesus was. And he went and he didn't preach any other name but the name of Jesus Christ. Because he realized who Jesus was. He knew that he could be reconciled, and he wanted that for all of his other brothers and sisters, all the people of his nation, that they too would be reconciled, that they would be in a right relationship with the Father because of Jesus Christ. So he went to the synagogues, and he didn't preach about him. He didn't preach about anybody else. He preached about who? Jesus. Jesus. Only Jesus. The subject of our message this year cannot be clouded with anything else other than the name of Jesus. Turn with me to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, verse 10. Only Jesus. It says, "Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you." Jump down to verse 12. "Neither is there salvation in any other." Who else is there salvation in? Nobody. "For there is none other name under heaven given among men," so no other man's name brings you hope. Only the name of Jesus Christ, whereby we must be saved. The message of the believer is to only be about Christ. Turn with me to Acts 1:8. What does Jesus himself say as he gave us the command? Who are we to be talking about? Jesus, Acts 1:8, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me or of me. Who is he telling us to talk about? Jesus. Jesus is saying, your message is to be about me, because only in me is there salvation. And Paul went straight to the synagogues and preached Christ. Only Jesus. Because he knew finally the salvation that was experienced because of Jesus Christ. God is a jealous God. He will not share his glory with anyone. Turn to Exodus 20. We must be careful of adding anything else to the message of salvation. It is only through Christ, only through Jesus. And adding to the name of Jesus, taking away from the name of Jesus, robs God from his glory. And God will not be robbed. Exodus 20, verse 2. God, speaking to Israel, he says, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. He says, remember who I am. I rescued you. I saved. Here, Egypt is a picture of sin and bondage and captivity. And God is saying, I rescued you. I am the one who saves. I save. Nobody else got you out of Egypt. It was me. He didn't say, remember what, all the things that Moses did? It's not about Moses. It was the power of God working through Moses. It is about God. God alone. It goes on in verse 3. He says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. So you can put a god next to him then, right? That's okay. No. But it says before him. What about after him? It's okay to have multiple as long as he's on the top. No. You put nothing above him. You put nothing next to him. And you put nothing under him. It is God and God alone. Don't believe me? Look what he says next. Thou shalt, in verse 4, thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or in any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. He's covered pretty much everything. Anything that's in there, I did that, as God is saying. That's my work, but that's not me. You don't worship that, you worship me. Verse 5, thou shalt not bow down thyself to them. Don't worship idols, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God. He's a jealous God. It's a righteous jealousness. No one else is deserving the glory. Only God. He says, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children. Like we talked about, sin has consequences. And you know that your sin does not just affect you. Sin affects generations. Parents, your sin affects your children. Grandparents, your sin affects your children and your grandchildren and their grandchildren. Visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. He's saying, if you worship another god other than me, put anything above me, next to me, under me, you are showing that you hate me. But, he goes on to say, the hope in verse 6, but God, but his grace, but he shows mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. He will give unfailing love to those who follow his commandments. He has told us, those who believe in Jesus, there is one name, one message, and it is Jesus Christ. Is the subject clear? Jesus. Only Jesus. Number two. The subject is clear. The Bible is clear. Saul was clear. Only Jesus. So we know the subject of our message is what? Jesus. When? Now we're going to look at the timing of the message. When do we share it? There's several good answers. Mine is immediately. The timing of our message, immediately. When do we share it? When did Saul share the message? Did he wait till he went to seminary? Did he wait till he understood all of the Bible, all of God's writings at that time, where he could make all the connections of the Old Testament in Christ? And it was clear as day. And he was sinless. Did he wait for any of those? What does it say in the beginning of verse 20? Straightway, immediately. Straight is straight, right? No detours. He didn't pause. He straightway, immediately, he didn't wait till he had his PhD in theology to share Christ. He took what he knew. What did it say that he knew at the end of verse 20? He knew that Jesus was what? The Son of God. So what did he go and share? He shared what he knew. He shared what he knew. He shared the truth that he knew. It may not have been as much as others, but he took what he knew that was truth about Jesus Christ, and he took it to the place he knew, the synagogues, and he said, Jesus is the Son of God. He's the Messiah. He's the promised one. He's the one we've been waiting for. Immediately, a new Christian, he shared the hope of Jesus. The challenge for us is to take the subject of Jesus Christ, take the truths you know, and take them into the areas where you live, where you work, where you go to school. Take it. Don't wait. Don't hesitate. Because the same Spirit that was living in Paul is the same Spirit that is living in you. Thanks, Bob. Don't let age stop you. I'm too young. I'm too old. 1 Timothy 4:12. Are you sure you want to go to that church? Have you seen how young that pastor is? First Timothy 4:12, let no man despise thy youth. And maybe youth is not just an age thing. Maybe it's a spiritual thing. Maybe you're 80 years old or 90 years old and you've just been saved. Or maybe you've been away from Christ for a long time. Whatever you have and whatever you know about Christ, do not hesitate. Look what it says here. It says, and be thou an example of the believers in word by your what you say and in conversation. Now that is not what you say. That is your lifestyle, your actions. Let your words and actions show Jesus to others. It says, in charity, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity, young or old, let your words and actions share the hope of Jesus right now. Right now. Not when you get home. Not after you go to Chili's. Right now. Now, in this moment, your words and actions, let them Share the message of Jesus Christ, the hope of Jesus Christ. Don't let your past hinder you. But you don't know what I've done. You don't know what others will say. Look at Saul. He had just persecuted, killed, threatened, pulled people out of their homes because they believed in Jesus. Did he let that hinder him, stop him from sharing the name of Jesus? No, he realized truth. 1 Timothy 1:15, he knew this about himself. He knew he was a sinner. He said, Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. He said, I'm the chief of sinners. There's nobody like me. But he did not let his past stop him. He did not let what others may think or say hinder him from doing what he knew was the right thing to do. People will bring up your past because people talk. If you're talking, don't. If you're talking about somebody else in their past, don't do that. We're all sinners saved by grace. Saul knew that. I'm the chiefest of sinners. Yet God has forgiven me. God loves me. And I'm not going to let anything that has happened in my past keep me from following Jesus. Grace, love, mercy. I don't care what you did yesterday. I know that there's forgiveness for you today. Saul knew he was forgiven. Listen to me today. We say this a lot, and I know I say it again and again, but if you don't speak truth to yourself, nobody will. You are loved. You are forgiven. You are chosen by God to serve Him. That's who you are. When's the time to serve? Now, because of those truths. It doesn't matter what others say. We serve God and God alone. Nothing should keep us from following Him. Saul rested in this hope of message, in the hope of this message. Turn with me to Acts 16, verse 23. Another incredible story. A spoiler alert for our study in Acts. We're going ahead a little bit. If you have believed in the name of Jesus Christ, you have the confidence of forgiveness. The confidence to immediately take the hope of Jesus, the message, to all the world. Acts 16, verse 23, this is Saul now being referred to as Paul and Silas as they were proclaiming the message of Christ. It says, and when they had laid many stripes upon them, Saul, Paul, and Silas were arrested. Many stripes means they were whipped. They were beaten. It says, and they were cast into the prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. They were thrown into jail. And they said, do not let these men escape. Verse 24, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison, because he didn't want anything to happen to them. So he didn't just put them in the inner or the outer prison, he put them in the inner prison. Deeper in, so they couldn't get out. And made their feet fast in the stocks. They locked them up. Verse 25, but in the midst of this, it says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, and they sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all of the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. He was in charge of keeping them all locked up. And he goes in there and believes everybody's gone. And so it's either let them take your life or you take your own life. And so he was going to take his own life. But, verse 28, but Paul cried with a loud voice saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Imagine the relief from that jailer. Oh. Imagine the thought. He had his sword ready to end his own life. Verse 29. Then he called for a light, the jailer did, and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? You know what that means? He went straight to that. So you think Paul and Silas had already told him, hey, you need to be saved? In that moment, he knew whatever it is that they knew was real. What must I do? And they said, believe. In verse 31, they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Verse 32, and they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, and he and all his house. What's that word again? Straightway. Immediately. He had just chained those men up. He immediately followed God. God's forgiveness and love and grace and mercy are for everyone. Everyone. If they're not for everyone, who are they not for? Me. If it's not for everyone, it's not for me. The jailer immediately took the message to his home, immediately followed. Number three. We have the subject of our message, Jesus, the timing of our message, immediately. And now number three, the growth of our message. Continually, we continue to grow. Saul didn't know much when he started, and that's okay. He took what he knew and he shared it, but he didn't stay there. He didn't have the desire to stay with what little he knew. He wanted to grow. He wanted to know more of Christ so he could share greater the message of Jesus. Verse 22 in Acts 9. Acts 9, verse 22, it says, but Saul increased the more in strength. His preaching became more and more powerful. It says, he confounded the Jews which were at Damascus, proving that this is very Christ. The proofs that he had confounded the Jews who knew the law. They couldn't say anything to him because he knew the word of God. 2 Timothy 2:15. One of the reasons why we are doing the Bible in a year is just to get more knowledge and continue to inundate ourselves with the word of God. Inundate yourself with the word of God. Discipleship begins in the home. If you are counting on the church and the church alone to disciple your family and your kids, it's not enough. Discipleship begins in the home. Reading the Word of God together, studying the Word of God, praying together, following God. Second Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Continually grow. The commandment in the Great Commission in Matthew 28:20 said, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Can you learn all the things in a day? Can you learn all the things in a week? In a month? Does God still reveal new things about himself to you every single day? It is a lifelong process. I hope he is. It is a lifelong process, continual growth that we go through. And thankfully, that could be kind of heavy. It doesn't depend on us. We can work and work and work, but without the grace of God in our lives, it means nothing. 1 Corinthians 15:10. Paul knew this. He said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace, which was bestowed or given upon me, was not in vain. He says, but I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Thankfully, we work and we work and we work and we work, but it's not us. Rest in the grace of God. God is working in your life. He will do a good work in you. Continue to grow. Continue to trust in him and the grace that he has given you. Depend on God. Depend on his power working through you. One last scripture and we'll be done. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 1. We're going to read down to verse 5. 1 Corinthians 2, 1. It says, and I, brethren, it's Paul speaking, when I came to you, I came not with excellency of speech or wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. He didn't come with fancy words, big theological words. He said in verse 2, for I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom. Love this. He said, I'm going to come and I'm going to use simple words. I came, simple words to you, only Jesus. Why? But in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. He said, rather than to rest on my clever words, my clever points, 1, 2, 3, I'm going to rely on the power of the Spirit. I'm going to give you truth, and I'm going to let God work. Verse 5, why? That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. It's not because anybody uses fancy words or clever illustrations. It is the power of God. The power of God. Grow continually, resting in the power of God. This message we cannot get wrong. We cannot dilute it. Truth is truth. Jesus is Jesus. Can add nothing to it. You can take nothing away from it. I'm going to show a couple pictures, and we've showed some before, but we can put that first picture up there. We've talked about this and shown pictures like this many times, but I woke up at 4:30 this morning because I got to preach. So who sleeps? And I woke up from a message from our missionary that we're going to go visit Here, a group of us in about 2 months are going to go over to Togo, Africa, and visit some of the feeding centers and the shelters that we've built and started. And he said, I want to share something from a pastor. This is Voto May. I've showed this picture before. Voto May, Africa, in Togo, Africa. 50 kids that we feed, this church sponsors, supports every single month. And we get to meet them here in a couple months. And go to the next picture. Why? So they can hear about Jesus. Only Jesus. It's the only message they need. Showing love in actions, helping them have food, but giving them Jesus. Because without Jesus, the food means nothing. Go to the next picture. It's Pastor Sangor. He wanted to share a message with us today. He wanted to say thank you. Because without Berean Baptist, obviously God gets the glory because it's His grace working through us. Without Berean Baptist, these children would not have heard the message and hope of Jesus Christ. He said 50 children have been saved. 50 children have been saved, have heard the message of Jesus Christ. Go to the next picture, please. The little boy on the right in the yellow shorts. Go to the next one. His name is Oscar. On January 1st, Oscar passed away. And Pastor Sangor had to preach his funeral. But he wanted us to know today, and he wanted to say thank you. Because Oscar is one of the little boys that put his faith in Jesus Christ. And he said at that funeral, he got to share a message of hope that one day we'll get to see Oscar. Because Oscar heard the message of Jesus Christ. This message is too important to get wrong. Eternity is in the balance. Jesus, only Jesus. Last week, we took a commitment together. We had cards up here on the altar that said, if you will commit with us on the new start that we talked about last week, acknowledging Jesus for who He is, seeking His plan for your life, following Him unashamedly, and trusting Him to give you the strength to do it, to come and take one of those cards. Doesn't mean we're going to have a perfect year. Doesn't mean we're going to be sinless. Doesn't mean we're not going to make a mistake. But together as the body of Christ, as Berean Baptist Church, we will commit together to this new start. If you have that, I want you to pull it out. Looks like this. If you did not get one and you want one, would you raise your hand right now? And we have men that will give these out to you. If you did not get one of these cards, raise your hands and we're going to pass them out because we're going to do something else with them today. It is everyone a minister. Everyone a minister. 1 Peter 4:10, as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. This year we're committing to serve God and God alone. And then on the back of this, what I want you to do today, if you'll commit to sharing the message of only Jesus, I want you to turn it around and on the back, write Jesus, only Jesus. Jesus, only Jesus. There is no hope in any other name. Praise God. Oscar heard that name and he heard that message. How many people in our backyards, in our city, still need to hear the name of Jesus Christ? Bow your heads and close your eyes.